a land that is cut through with lochs and mountains that weave like some kind of tartan kilt.
And you were gonna go there.
Which is called Scotland.
Scotland.
We're going on the trip of a lifetime.
Spent a lot of time here, obviously, shooting Outlander.
What is portrayed in the show is truthful in many ways.
Time travel is truthful.
Yeah, I wasn't necessarily thinking of the time travel bit.
Story of two men who know nothing.
I don't know what I'm doing.
I cannot believe that this was your idea of a good time.
This is a great example of amazing Scottish seafood.
The soldiers would dance the swords before they went into battle.
The origination of the Highland Games would come from the clan.
This land tells a story of its people.
Thank you for having us, Captain. Oh, if you take us back to shore, that would be great. Make it so.
Make it so? Make Seriously? It. Have you been waiting all day to say that?
Yeah.
That is impressive!
Here's to Scotland. Men in Kilts.
Men
in
Kilts.
Kilts,
a road trip with Sam McGrath.
We are here with Sam Heughan and Graham McTavish, who have taken us on an amazing road trip through Scotland in Men in Kilts on STARZ. And guys, it is such a fun show. It's a great like buddy travelogue. You have a wonderful relationship on the show, which is one reason it's such a joy to watch. Tell me how it came about. I know you were worked together on Outlander. So tell me how the show came about.
Well, yes, The show kind of came about mainly, we were both interested in trying to tell a story about Scotland. We were very passionate about sharing our love of Scotland with other people. That was the starting point. But originally, Sam suggested a podcast. And now I pretended to know what a podcast was, but didn't. So then that quickly changed into a filming project. And we had the conversation. And then 6 months later, we were actually doing it. So it happened actually very quickly once we got going.
Yeah, we both have this interest, I think, in Scottish history and, you know, a proud Scotsman. And, you know, Graham had an idea for a show about a decade ago, wasn't it, Graham? And
30 years ago.
And I even more than a decade, 3 decades. It's almost as old as I am. And yeah, and I also was looking to create, you know, some IP and some content that, that I was interested in and want to explore. And having both of us worked on Outlander, I wanted to kind of share the experience and the love of Scotland that we have with everyone else. And it really was a very organic process. You know, we sat down, Graham with a latte and me obviously with a drink, and it just really sort of came together.
Well, before this, we were talking a little bit about how your personalities have rubbed off on each other, shooting the show. Tell us, the rapport you have is so, so fun to watch. Do you guys really rib each other, tease each other that much in real life?
Yes, we do.
Yeah.
We do. It's actually got worse. It's got worse. When we made Outlander, it was quite mild, I would say. Mm-hmm. It was quite mild.
Yeah.
You know, because we knew each other on Outlander. We would spend social time with each other. But, you know, you have to be careful. You don't want to, like, insult people and get them upset and other things. So we were kind of testing the waters. But once we got into doing this, then all the gloves were off. And since then it's only got worse. I mean, really.
It has. This is the only time we're allowed to meet anymore, isn't it?
Yes, I'm in a safe house.
Yes, because we're kept separate because it's just become, become criminal, to be honest.
For each of you, what was the favorite scene that you filmed for Men in Kilts?
Oh, well, I could tell you, I'll tell you one of the favorite ones and I'll tell you my least favorite one. My favorite one would definitely be everything connected with Culloden. I just found the whole thing. It just, it ticked all the boxes for me. The location, the guests, the history, the emotion, the bagpipes, all of that just was great. Probably my least favorite was being stuck in a sidecar next to Sam as he was driding a motorbike. That was terrifying.
You look so happy in there. You look very content.
How did it end up? Yeah, how did it end up that Sam was always the one driving?
I know. I don't know. Well, I know why he was driving the camper, because the night before we had a little bit too much to drink, and I felt wretched the next morning as we walked into the car park at 7 o'clock, and Sam looked surprisingly sort of sprightly. And so he said, you know, who shall drive? Oh, why don't you drive, Sam? And I assumed that he had driven a vehicle like this before. And no, he hadn't. He hadn't driven a stick shift for, no. I think, 6 years. And so,
But I also hadn't insured you on any vehicle. So you weren't ever going to drive. I mean, it was pre-planned, but yes. But I agree. I mean, I think there's so many great moments, and I think Culloden was a good one. But for me, I guess I'm a huge sports fan. I think our sports episode is really engaging and a lot of fun. And you know, Murrayfield, which is the stadium of rugby, where there was unfortunately a defeat by Graham in the competition that we had. But yes, it's called a victory.
It's a victory for Graham. Yes, a victory.
Yeah, well, we try not to talk about that too much, but it was just a really memorable moment for me. You know, I've been going there for many years, and I got to meet some legends of Scottish rugby. But actually, one of my favourite moments to shoot was lowering Graham off a cliff. Obviously, that's going to be fun, but to watch him go through, you know, his fear, but actually conquer that and achieve this great moment. It was great. Storytelling, I think, and great TV, and I think that's the reason that I do rip him or try and put him in dangerous situations, is because I think everyone needs to witness that. It's great fun to see Graham angry, upset, hungry, and happy.
Yes, it was good to be taken out of my comfort zone.
Yes, you certainly are in that episode, and I liked the shot in that episode that there's actually a shot of the crew cheering you on. Because it was such a big moment that shot was included. Well, Sam, you mentioned that you met some really incredible people when you did that sporting episode. Oh, for both of you, who really stands out that you met during the filming of this?
It's a lot of the guests. We were very lucky. I mean, you couldn't make up some of the characters we met. They were larger than life. I mean, the McGregor and the McLaren?
McLaren Chiefs, yeah.
Those two arguing over the grave of Rob Roy McGregor. That was a pretty priceless moment. I mean, that kind of polite hatred between clans was just perfect. Alistair Moffat, the historian, talking about Culloden, he brought to life that battle right in front of us. And that was really special for me.
Yeah, I think for me, you know, we tried to bring guests that I think were, you know, either tied in with our journey, but also could be surprising. And for me, definitely one of the firm ones I really had to have in there was Tony Singh, who's this fantastic chef from Edinburgh. He's a Sikh, Scottish Sikh. And he has this really strong Edinburgh accent. He's very gregarious. He's great on camera. He's done a lot of cookery shows in the UK. And I just knew that people wouldn't be expecting this character to be from Scotland. And he really is a great Scottish treasure, really a national treasure, because he's a fantastic chef, a great personality, a great man, and provided us with some really delicious Scottish food with like this Indian spice to it. So I think it was nice to sort of try and surprise the viewer as well.
No, I like that about the show. We talked about the traditions of Scotland, but we also really saw modern Scotland, who lives there now. It wasn't just an historical travelogue. It was really a journey through the country as it is and what made it the way it is. So I'm wondering how you guys chose some of the people. Sam, I know you were an executive producer. How did you choose some of the people that you decided to interview? What was that process like?
Yeah, we were both execs on this, and we created the show. And I think when we first initially shot the sort of pilot material, you know, I knew I had a great many contacts from, you know, Claire, who runs the woolen mill up in Inverness, or, you know, the poet who we talked to, or, you know, the bards that we have as well. You know, I think just a lot of these guests were people that I knew from before, or even the clan chiefs, McGregor, you know, I'd met in other places. So I just wanted to sort of bring together all the contacts that I'd made, you know, over working on Outlander, which has almost been a decade now. So I wanted to bring all these people together. And I think, again, it was very much about a sort of organic thing. As soon as we started to reach out to, you know, these guests, the people just jumped at it because they wanted to tell their story and share their love of Scotland as well. And you see that. And there's a great many that we had to drop as well that we just didn't have time for.
We were spoiled for choice. We really were. I mean, I'm sure they won't mind me describing them in this way. They are wonderfully eccentric characters in the best possible sense. They are passionate, not just about the country, but about their given subject. And they love to talk. They love to talk. And, you know, they really, a lot of the time, they did our job for us. I mean, we just needed to turn up and turn the cameras on. Off they went. It was absolutely wonderful. And so when you see us in those situations, reacting in real time, I mean, we are two people that are fascinated by what we're being told. And hopefully the way that we've done it makes the audience feel that they are there with us, you know? They're on this crazy journey where we're encountering these extraordinary people.
And it does go from clan chiefs to, you know, to chefs, to whoever, but also to, you know, to the shepherds that we're working with, this whole family, three generations of shepherds who were just generous there and open with what they own and what their livelihood, and they were just wanted to share it with us. And we felt very, very, very touched and very lucky to be in that situation, to have that access.
It was really beautiful because you two are native sons of Scotland and you're connected to the country. And I'm wondering how, do you feel your connection deepened to Scotland doing this? And is there a moment that you recall while shooting the show where you learned something that you didn't know about your native country?
Yeah, I definitely felt a deeper connection afterwards. I thought I knew quite a lot about Scotland, actually. And I really, my ignorance was hugely exposed. I learned so much on that trip. I mean, in terms of moments, there were lots of moments, really. A lot of them involved, really, when we, between shots, actually, between scenes, if we had a moment where we were waiting, or if we were able to look out at the landscape around us and see this sort of place of living history, just looking out across this amazing, the Minch, or, you know, the mountains of Skye, if you look at the Old Man of Stor, the Kerrang, just being in those places, you felt very, very rooted, I guess, in the country that you come from.
Yeah, we wanted to celebrate that. Obviously, we have a whole episode that's dedicated to the natural beauty of Scotland. And it's actually, I think, one of the strongest episodes, because we just let Scotland speak for itself, so to speak, you know. But I think, to be honest, you know, we also crafted it in a way that we ended the last episode with Culloden, and everything before that is a kind of build up to this battle. And for people that don't know, it's this moment in history that really changed this battle, that really changed the landscape of Scotland, but also had influences across the world. And I think that's why we ended on that one, because we wanted it to people to realize that this small battle in the 1700s, you know, actually had repercussions and led to people, you know, emigrating to different parts of the world. So it's a really seismic moment. And I think hopefully people will understand that Scotland may be far away for them, but it still has an influence on them.
Well, we're all touched by Scottish culture, and in the United States, definitely we have a Scottish heritage, especially in certain parts of the country, which you cover in Outlander.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. In North Carolina, you know, there, and also Canada, and then you look at, you know, Australia, New Zealand, and other places. You know, it really, the Scottish influence really does go further afield, and yeah, it's fantastic. It's still celebrated, you know, and I think hopefully people around the world have really enjoyed the show, because it gives them a little slice of what they're maybe missing.
Yeah, I live in New Zealand, and there are more McTavishes in New Zealand than there are in Scotland.
Really?
So many left, and Canada. But New Zealand and Canada. There's a McTavish Road in Canada.
Well, how did you feel when you saw the McTavish? Well, you got to see your McTavish clan castle, Graham. You actually visited that on the show. Describe what that was like.
It was a very moving moment.
Tell us, Graham.
It was a very, very moving moment. I was particularly impressed at how the clan had expanded into trailer parks. I thought that was really good. That they hadn't restricted themselves to the castle. They thought, what can we do? What can we do other than build the castle? And caravans was the next obvious choice.
Yeah, they seem to have expanded into that. And the castle is just laid barren, really, isn't it?
Well, you know, their attentions and energies went into other things.
They have all mod cons now.
They do. Mm. They do. Mm. They do. Why live in a castle when you can live in a caravan?
So I wanted to ask too, these are very dynamic episodes. They are short. You know, a lot of travel shows are maybe an hour long. These are about a half an hour. They're these quick bites. What was your goal? Why did you choose that length? And how did you want to make these different from other travel shows that you had seen?
Yeah, the time of it is interesting because we played around with that. And at first we were talking a lot about, you know, short content. You know, there were these Quibi, there was all these smaller content productions out there. And then we almost thought about making it into just a one-off movie. But to be honest, I think the 30-minute really works for us. It's short, it's sharp, it keeps people's attention. We didn't want to sort of lose people and sort of get bogged down too much in the, the academic side of it, but we wanted to impart some information without sort of getting people lost in it. So I think that time period worked best for us, and it keeps people wanting more as well. And I think that's important, that people leave it going, God, I want to know more about it. And then hopefully they'll binge watch it again.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, in terms of the difference between us and maybe other things is, well, what we wanted perhaps to achieve was that sense of spontaneity in the production itself, so that you, as I said before, I think that the audience feel like they're very much with you in the camper van, and that the genuineness of our friendship, our relationship, is what sort of binds the show together. That's the running thread through the whole thing. Our relationship in the camper van, and the fact that we are really taking this journey together and encountering these people at the same time that the audience are, I think that's what we were really going for with the show.
Did you guys really sleep in that van?
Every night.
Every night, yes. Yes. Top bunk and bottom bunk, topped and tailed.
Well, Sam, what do you love most about Graham and traveling with him?
Careful.
Oh, here we go. There's a long list. Oh, it's no, love. Oh, I see. Right.
Yes, the short list.
Yes, the shorter one. To be honest, he's so reliable. You can rely on Graham. He's just reliably fun, reliably actually good natured, and even when he's being angry or shouty or hungry, which is, you can also rely on. You know, it's short lived, and actually, he is playing out very much to the camera. So he's a wonderful travel companion. You honestly, you wouldn't want anyone else. You just have to make sure you bring plenty supplies of snacks for him to eat, because they'll be gone in the first 10 minutes. So just be sure to bring much food.
I'm very easygoing as long as I'm fed. Yeah. Really. I'm like a sort of like a pet. Mm-hmm.
Well, you do one entire episode on food and drink. So is there a standout Scottish dish, Graham, for you, since we've talked about your endless hunger a few times now?
I've been asked this a few times, and I think really, for me, the great thing about a lot of Scottish cooking is just the quality of the produce. And sometimes the more simple the preparation of food, for me, the better. So I often choose oysters, just lock fine oysters, just with a little bit of lemon, you know, some vinegar. Absolutely can't eat them. Fantastic.
Craft services were pulling their hair out on this job, but and let it also be said that every chef or restaurant that we visited in the show Graham then went on to revisit himself to have a
several times.
So
I have a very good long relationship now with Tony Singh, and
all in the name of research, of course.
Of course. Absolutely. Well, I mean, Graham, we've heard from Sam about what he loves about you. What do you love about him and traveling with him?
So difficult. The genuine thing about Sam, and I think I've said this in connection with other things as well, the standout quality that Sam has is he is exactly as he appears, a lovely, lovely guy. He doesn't get grumpy. He doesn't get, you know, he's a little bit the opposite of me. So in that sense, when I look at Sam, I mean, it would be terrible to go on a road trip with somebody who is exactly like me. It would be a nightmare. So it's good that the person driving the van is mischievous, but good-hearted. Mm-hmm. So, and he had my back. Sometimes he was pushing me, but he had my back.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, you definitely like pushed each other and egged each other on. And Graham, you actually got pranked a few times. Sam, why was it so important for you to prank Graham?
Yes, why?
I mean, honestly, the very first moment we got in the camper van and I told him I didn't know how to drive the thing, I could see in his eyes this look of terror. And I just thought, this is exactly what our audience needs to see. They need to see this man who, you know, comes across so sort of brave and strong and gruff, is deep down a quivering wreck when it comes to anything that I involve him with. So yeah, I just realized, and it, to be honest, it's all selfish. It's just, I really enjoy it. It's a great pastime. And I think if I get as much enjoyment out of it, then hopefully other people do as well. So
I couldn't believe how literally he would do jump scares. I mean, it was like being with a child. Yeah. He would jump out at me.
It works.
Yeah. I mean, we didn't even put all of them in. It was constant.
Yeah, but when it came down to it, Graham, you won in the sports competition and you were a better basket weaver.
Oh, come on.
And you know, I mean, a few of the things, you know, you really, you know, it was like a quiet triumph.
Yes,
no matter how decent you were.
Quiet triumph, did you say? The man gloats. The man gloated for a whole episode.
No. I wear that mantle lightly. Yes, it's sometimes a burden, but I try and cope.
And how much whiskey did you guys drink during this entire trip?
Oh, none.
The first day when we got in the van, the first place we went to was a pub, and Sam had organized a whiskey tasting for 9 a.m. And so we had six cask strength whiskeys at 9 o'clock in the morning. Now, I hasten to add, Sam did not drive the van after that, but nevertheless, that set the tone. He managed to have whiskey about his person in any situation. I just never quite understood how he managed it, but there was always a flask. Yeah,
magic.
He did have a flask a lot. I mean, and you guys travel by so many different, you know, ways of locomotion. You have the van, but you also have bicycles. You have the motorcycle with the sidecar. You do some trekking around. I love that, actually. Like, it's kind of like you have an anticipation of each episode. Like, okay, what are we going to see them try to do in this one? What was the thinking ahead of time on kind of showing you traveling these different ways?
Yeah, we did, actually. I remember I tried to get as much in as possible. I mean, I'm a huge fan of the sort of adventure travel shows, and I think I wanted us to do as much as we possibly could, you know, sort of activity wise as well. And yeah, I think it was just, you know, down to like what we could fit into the show, but it felt good to sort of to mix it up and to surprise the viewer and to surprise Graham, to be honest. Again, it comes down to just seeing if I can put him in an uncomfortable situation.
Yes, the motorbike and sidecar was an extraordinary moment. Getting into it, basically a metal coffin, with a man who had never ridden a motorbike
No, I'd ridden a motorbike. I just didn't have a license. So I suppose the same thing, really.
A minor point.
And the motorbike was spraying out gas at the time, petrol. Yeah. It had a leak. So, complete death trap, yeah.
Well, what were some of the adventures you had that did not make it into the show that you kind of wish had made it in?
We met some, we went to some amazing castles that we weren't able to include. There were just so many. Castle Cawdor, Lady Cawdor, who just casually had a copy of Shakespeare's 1623 folio on her table, an actual copy. It just blew my head off. A wonderful Swedish guy who owns a castle in Scotland called Finladdick Castle. The wonderfully named Mons Bolin. He looked like Rutger Hauer, literally. A character from fiction. Like the James Bond of the Highlands was there. And I wish we'd been able to include them all, but we simply couldn't.
I mean, I think, you know, when we were just in post-production, you know, we knew we had a lot of content. Obviously, we shot a bunch of material before we then went back to reshoot the next year. So we had so much material. And as Graham said, you know, we had to just drop so many things that we wish we'd included. But the more we watched it, the more we realized, you know, it's like the more that we were active in episodes or in scenes, the sort of more engaging it was for the audience. But there was some great stuff, as Graham said, that we missed out, and some great characters. There's so much of Scotland to explore. It's kind of endless, really.
Well, I did like, too, that you didn't hide certain things. Like, you guys took a Gaelic lesson out in a garden and were attacked by midges, those nasty little bugs that come to Scotland in the summertime or the spring. I'm not sure. But you made it humorous. You continued the lesson, but you also acknowledged that you were being attacked by these bugs. So was that part of the philosophy of the show, is we are going to keep it real? We're not going to be these distanced kind of hosts.
Sure. Yes, absolutely. And all credit to Sam in that situation, because he really was being attacked. I mean, the midges kind of left me alone and really concentrated, like battalions of midges just attacking him repeatedly. And I mean, I'm not going to say I enjoyed it, because that would be cruel, but it was quite amusing at the time to see him slapping his own face.
But I think it was the same with every scene, you know, and every guest and every activity. Actually, we went out of our way to not prep or to even practice, you know, for instance, the sports. We weren't allowed to practice much that I wanted to. So therefore, you know, we really were experiencing everything for the first time. We're having these conversations. I mean, of course, we did, you know, sit down with a guest or whatever and work out, you know, a rough plan. But then wherever the conversation or activity went, it really was just a very organic process. And I think that's kind of what it's exciting, that it's you just don't know what's going to happen.
Well, that's what makes it fun to watch, too, because it doesn't feel rehearsed. It doesn't feel scripted. You know, you feel like, well, what could, anything could happen. You know, you really did succeed in making it feel like we are along with you on the trip, and we're not sure where we're going next.
Oh, thank you. Well, we yes, exactly. We had no idea where we were going next.
But I think also, you know, something that is, you know, so scripted or produced in that sense is, it's just, we've seen it before. And I think that's the special, unique angle that we have, is that we're kind of with us on that tandem bicycle or in that car and in that camper van, and you're just experiencing it with us, and who knows what's around the corner.
Yeah.
And another fun thing about the show is that we cut in some Outlander moments, especially some key moments between the two of you. Why did you choose to do that? And how do you think it helps illustrate or lift up this show?
Yeah, I think it gives context, you know, like how we met, why we're there, you know. So it obviously gives people an insight into our lives as actors, but also, you know, you can't sort of turn away, you know, this high production valued show, you know, so being able to fall back on that and use that just to illustrate. I mean, the Culloden episode is prime example. You know, we could never have produced that for Men in Kilts, but to be able to use that to storytell, and actually it's not promoting Outlander. It's just showing that here's what happened, and it helps the viewer to understand the story that we're trying to we're trying to investigate.
Yeah, we tried to be quite judicious in the use of it, especially in those earlier episodes. We didn't want that to be a big feature of the show at all. But we did lean into it for sure in the Culloden episode, because as Sam says, I think it just really quite literally brought to life what we were describing in the rest of that episode. When Alistair Moffat is talking about the Highland Charge and how the British met the Highland Charge, sometimes that can seem a little bit academic and, right, well, what exactly does that mean? But if you, boom, suddenly you're there and shells are going off and people are screaming and swords are flying, and that really helped tell the story.
Well, it's a wonderful story that you've told on Men in Kilts, and I thank you so much for speaking to us today. And Sam and Graham, is there going to be a season two?
We definitely hope so.
If I can break him out of his solitary confinement and put him back in
camp.
Yes. The hunt is on. But we'd love to, yes. We're working on it.
Okay.
Yeah, we are.
Okay. Well, thank you guys so much. I really appreciate your time.
No, thank you. Great to see you again.
Thank you.